We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
The Dialogue, the community voice of Southern California's young professional network. Relevant discussions about the thoughts, concerns, opportunities, and challenges faced by today's generational leaders. Real talk, real people. This is The Dialogue. The Dialogue. With Starlett Quarles on LA Talk Live and streaming live at www.latalklive.com.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome once again to The Dialogue. Real talk, real people. I'm your host, Starlett Quarles, and yes, I am a little bit hoarse today, but I'm going to do my best to project and enunciate so that you can hear me on The Dialogue, streaming live every Wednesday from 5 to 6, where we like to talk about the discussions that are relevant to today's generational leaders. Now, today we are continuing our two-month series on the dynamics of Black relationships. We've been talking about our interpersonal relationships between Black men and women this month. We're going to continue this series next month when we get into more about marriage. But today we are talking about the dynamics of Black men and women, from dating to marriage to sex to Black families. These are a 90-minute special series for the next couple of months because we want to engage you in our conversation. So please give us a call here today at 323-473-3100. We have a special Skype line for this conversation. It's a 90-minute segment, so we're going to invite you all to call in at 323-473-3100. We have a special section from 6 to 6:30, but we're going to be opening up the line starting at 5:30. Now, if you missed last week's show, we talked about dating in L.A., and our guests included filmmaker and producer Tim Alexander from Diary of a Tired Black Man, screenwriter and author Monique Matthews, who is also our sponsor tonight from Sex Free. Remember her book, Sex Free, A Not-So-Modern Approach to Dating and Relationships. She's going to be here. We also had IT entrepreneur Man Moore last week. So if you missed last week's show on dating in L.A., please go to our website at thedialoguela.com. That is thedialoguela.com. On tonight's show, we're talking about stereotypes of today's Black men, especially in light of the recent Zimmerman verdict. How are we portraying our Black men? How is the media portraying our Black men? What stereotypes come to mind when you think of Black men? So to help us flesh out this conversation today, we have entrepreneur Herman So Relevant Jones, a screenwriter and author and professor Monique Matthews, community activist Derek Steele, and educator Callista Watson, all here to talk about the dynamics of Black relationships, specifically stereotypes of today's Black men. Again, give us a call today, 323-473-3100, 323-473-3100, or send us your comments or questions on our Facebook page, facebook.com/thedialoguela. And if you do have my text number, text me and give me your questions or comments for our conversation today on the stereotypes of Black men, brought to you by Sex Free and Not So Modern Approach to Dating and Relationships. Check out Monique's website at sexfreebook.com. We're going to take a quick commercial break, and when we get back, we're going to get right into our conversation on stereotypes and today's Black men right here with the horse, Starlett Quarles, on The Dialogue. We'll be right back.
Young Connection, your one-stop connection for all your graphic design and commercial printing needs. Young Connection is a full-service printing and media design company dedicated to providing the highest level of customer service and satisfaction. Young Connection provides swift response and rapid turnaround services for banners, brochures, business cards, letterheads, church bulletins, funeral programs, flyers, logo design, posters, and much, much more, all at an affordable price. Young Connection, the official printing company of LA Talk Live. Give them a call at 310-491-3336. That's 310-491-3336. Or visit their website at www.youngconnection.com. That's www.youngconnection.com. Young Connection Printing and Media Services, proud sponsors of LA Talk Live, where it's more than just talk.
Do you have or know of someone with a child or adult family member with developmental disabilities that would benefit from a social recreation program in the South Los Angeles area? At Ability First's Harry A. Meyer Center at 8090 Crenshaw Boulevard in Inglewood, we offer afternoon and after-school care programs for children and adults with disabilities, which includes socialization, recreation, community outings, independent living skill training, as well as physical fitness activities. You can reach us at 323-753-3101 and visit us at www.abilityfirst.org.
Sisters, how y'all feel? Brothers, y'all all right? See how y'all groove today.
Welcome back to the dialogue. Real talk, real people. I'm your host, Starlett Quarles, sounding like Tyrone today. I'm a little hoarse, but I'm here. Happy to continue our discussion on the dynamics of black relationships. And today's conversation is specifically on stereotypes and today's black men. This is a 90-minute special. We're going to have a call-in segment starting at 5:30. We already got some calls. We're excited that you guys are calling, but please call us back at 5:30 when we're going to open up the lines. 323-473-3100. 323-473-3100. We want you to hear a little bit of the conversation and then give us a call after 5:30. We're going to keep the lines open all the way until the end of the show at 6:30. So let's get on with our conversation. Today, we're talking about stereotypes and today's black men, and I'm going to introduce our esteemed panel today. Sitting right here with me, next to me, is a community activist and civic engagement program director for the Social Justice Learning Institute, a friend of the dialogue that's been here before. Yeah. Welcome back, Derek Steele.
Hey. How's everybody doing? It's really good to be back.
Sitting next to Derek, we have screenwriter, author, and sponsor for this this month's series, Monique Matthews of Sex Free, a Not-So-Modern Approach to Dating and Relationships. She also has a master's in African American Studies, as well as film and television, a master's in film and television from UCLA, and she's an associate professor at Santa Monica College. So I want to make sure, we've been talking about it for the past 3 weeks, but I definitely want you to give her credentials in addition to talking about her book. So welcome back, my soror.
Thank you so much.
From UCLA, Ms. Monique Matthews.
So happy to be here.
Sitting next to Monique is entrepreneur Herman Sir Relevant Jones, a good friend of mine. He's been here on the dialogue before. I think you came for the religion versus spirituality one, didn't you?
Yeah.
Well, welcome back, Herman, president of Savage Breed Productions. And last but certainly not least is my sister from Law Pie. We graduated in 2010 class, community mentor and educator, Calista Watson. Welcome, Calista, first time to the dialogue. I know you'll be back. So today's show is on stereotypes and today's black men. So what I'm going to do is we're going to start this conversation obviously talking about the Zimmerman verdict and its impact on the black community and the perceptions of black men. So I'm going to play a sound bite from the no guilty verdict.
In the Circuit Court of the 18th Judicial Circuit in and for Seminole County, Florida, State of Florida versus George Zimmerman, verdict, we the jury find George Zimmerman not guilty. So say we all, four person.
Does either side want to poll the jury?
We would, Your Honor.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, as your juror number is being called, please answer whether this is your verdict.
Juror B-29, is this your verdict?
Yes.
Juror B-76, is this your verdict?
Yes.
Juror B-37, is this your verdict?
Yes.
Juror B-51, is this your verdict?
Yes.
Juror E-6, is this your verdict?
Yes.
Juror E-40, is this your verdict?
Yes.
Thank you.
Ladies, I wish to thank you for your time and consideration of this case. I also wish to advise you of some very special privileges enjoyed by jurors.
Okay, so that was the reading of the no guilty verdict this past week with George Zimmerman. So I'm going to start with you, Derek. What was your initial reaction when you heard the verdict? And I'm going to ask you talking to the mic.
Yeah, I have to say, you know, I wasn't surprised.
Why?
I wasn't surprised. That being a black man in America and understanding some of the things about the case, you know, I was hopeful, you mm-hmm. know, hopeful that justice would be served. But, you know, when it came down that it was not guilty, you know, I wasn't surprised.
Okay, Monique.
Shock and anger.
Mm-hmm.
I woke up to it. I was taking a nap. And it's one of those things as I couldn't watch the coverage because they kept talking in the coverage about how the prosecution was blowing the case. And mm-hmm. I was just praying against all prayers that somehow the jurors would be able to see through that.
So you weren't following the case every single day?
I couldn't. Okay. I mean, I just couldn't.
All right, Herman.
I wasn't either following the case every single day. But okay. I was with three older black women when that jury verdict went down. I didn't even know it was on that day.
Okay.
It's like somebody punched you in the gut mm-hmm. and it just slowly starts to hurt more and more. It's despicable.
Mm, okay, Calista.
Mm-hmm. I was in a friend's house as well, and a friend came downstairs and said, not guilty.
Mm.
I said, what? There was this visceral reaction. Mm-hmm. I just felt dumbfounded.
Okay.
Like it was impossible.
All right. Mm-hmm. Now, what did you guys think of the nation's reaction? I mean, they've been protests, and specifically here in L.A. So, Calista, I'm going to start with you. How do you feel about the national reaction to the verdict, and specifically how we were acting up here in L.A.?
Well, good overall, there's been a national reaction.
Okay.
And that people are taking action and concerned and speaking out and in the places and spaces that people have been demonstrating peacefully. The other night, and I, from what I understand last night as well in Hollywood, where individuals were hurting folks, damaging property, I think that really moves beyond the scope of what we're trying to do here, what's best for the community.
Okay.
You know, it's counterintuitive to the message. And
okay. Mm-hmm. All right.
I want to know what people think is going to happen with these protests.
Okay.
Because it's cool. You're standing up. You're saying, I'm not going for it. But what is your overall plan? Mm-hmm. Because at the end of the day, they don't give a damn that you're protesting.
Okay.
All right. So we need to really form and get together and come up with a plan amongst ourselves.
I was going to say, Monique, I mean, what should we do? I mean, how should we react? I mean, this isn't 1992. This isn't a Rodney King verdict. I mean, this verdict didn't come down in Los Angeles. So what are your thoughts on how the nation's reacting and how we should be reacting?
Well, I think that what we're seeing is a diverse approach. I mean, some people are angry and some people are protesting because that had been the standard for the last, 40 years. I don't necessarily think that is the most proactive standard, but I don't think that this is something that you fight in one way.
Okay.
I don't think that that's the right approach. I do want to say what concerned me about what just happened in terms of on Crenshaw, when I was watching the coverage, those were kids for the most part. They looked like 15 to maybe 13 or 15 year olds who didn't have any direction.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the comments that I saw on social media, particularly from people who I know 20 years ago were either there in the thick of Circuit City trying to steal something or they were like, they had thugs, and it's like they're kids. Like, we have to provide direction. Direction starts at the top and goes down.
Okay.
Just as we don't want, you know, Trayvon to be labeled a thug, and he didn't even do what those kids did.
Okay.
If they're without direction and they're angry, we have to stop them, pull them in, and say, this is how we'd like for you to respond.
Okay, let me get your thoughts.
Well, I want to say that I think the dialogue that you've been working to create over the last year, this year, about the what we should be doing as a black community,
in terms of an agenda.
And bringing the agenda mm-hmm. together, I think now more than ever, like the gentleman said, you know, we have to come up with a plan.
Absolutely,
what
we're at
it
the
is,
forefront.
Is. Exactly.
Our issues are at the forefront, and then, so this is a time for us to be able to capitalize and mobilize on what we are going to do as a community. So that leads me into the couple of sound bites I want to play from Obama's statement to the Jim. It's just a brief statement from ABC News, and then Eric Holder's response at the DST conference about filing civic charges. So let's go to those couple of sound bites.
President Obama's calling for calm in a statement released yesterday. The president said, quote, I know this case has elicited strong passions, and in the wake of the verdict, I know those passions may be running even higher. But we are a nation of laws, and a jury has spoken.
Now, of course, as this celebration unfolds, we are also mindful of the pain felt by our nation surrounding the tragic, unnecessary shooting death of Trayvon Martin in Sanford, Florida last year. And we are cognizant of the fact that the state trial reached its conclusion over the weekend. The Justice Department shares your concern. I share your concern. And as we first acknowledged last spring, we have opened an investigation into this matter.
Now, Mugni, I'm going to start with you. So tell me your initial reactions. We only played a small part of Obama's statement on the Zimmerman trial, but I know he got a lot of flack from the black community.
I was very concerned when I heard Mr. Obama's statement.
Why? What were you
particularly
concerned?
Particularly the line, we are a nation of laws and a jury has spoken.
Okay.
Because based upon the laws that were, we are a nation of laws, but the laws that were established were unjust to begin with. So in light of our civil disobedience that we've had in this country to get the rights that we have and to fight to be recognized for the human beings we are, we have consciously and consistently had to challenge the rules from being three-fifths of a person to not being able to vote to today. So when he said that, I didn't like that at all. And then the jury has spoken. I had a huge problem with
Derek,
that.
Derek, I saw you shaking your head. How did you feel about Obama's statements?
I mean, he's the president of the country of not just black people. You know, that was, again, I wasn't surprised. Okay. that was his response.
Yeah, but he's already in office. It doesn't like he has to fight to be in office again.
I hear you. But my thing is, you know, and you know, even Eric Holder's response, you know, is not something I was definitely response. I wasn't surprised by that either. But what I feel like what needs to happen is on a local level, like we really have to get focused about making things different for ourselves.
Okay.
We've gotten so entrenched in trying to fight this fight to get them to look at us equally, right? And I feel like honestly, we need to really get along together and fix our own communities, so that we don't have to deal with people outside of those, you know, when we go outside of those communities having those problems. I feel like
all the other
we need
ones
to
do
focus
it.
On a thing here.
All the other
exactly.
ones do it. Calista.
Exactly.
As far as the president's statements go regarding the outcome of the trial, as the president, he can't overturn the jury's decision. And essentially in his statement, he's saying, hey, we're a country of laws, this is how it's set up. We wish the outcome was different. And yes, it is true. The laws are tinkered with in many cases, clearly with the Zimmerman trial, to place African Americans at a disadvantage.
Okay.
So I think pulling the lens back, that's what needs to be addressed. You know, are the laws fairly working toward people? Does our justice system need to be?
Okay. Herman, what did you think about the NAACP pushing their petition for the civil case, as well as Eric Holder's statement?
Good.
Okay, elaborate.
I mean, great. Exactly, I mean, right. At the end of the day, I think that, man, it's a spiritual revolution that needs to take place within our own minds. Like you were saying, that's the only – these guys have been playing this game for a long time. They built this country on blood. And so the fact that we're going to try to overturn what we initially came here to be, which was slaves – it's not going to happen. You got to revolutionize in your mind and link with your fellow human beings that are with that program.
Okay.
They ain't changing nothing.
All right.
I don't expect them to.
Yeah, I totally feel you on that, bro. And I want to take it that next step further. You know, in these communities like the Inglewoods or the Comptons that we have local governments that we can actually take on and be in charge of. We have local police departments. We have our own local school districts. Like, we need to really get in there. We need to have all these educators that we've been cultivating over the years. We need to create pipelines for them to come back and actually teach our children along the way.
So what do you guys think about the mobilizing and the rallying and the protesting? I mean, what do you think about all that as a tactic?
I think energetically it's okay in terms of creating awareness and letting people know this is not okay.
Right.
But what it needs to be followed up with is action that works.
Okay.
So we look at the civil rights movement boycotting.
was very effective. Not taking those buses, making people feel those
exactly.
And so I think in our community we're underusing the power of our dollars.
Absolutely.
Indeed. And so that really speaks. This is America.
Absolutely. Speak I'm glad you said that. That's my new slogan. It only costs you a decision. Word. You know what I mean? You know, that doesn't cost you anything to not be able to not fly to Florida. I mean, I'm so down with, you know, Stevie Wonder saying that he's not going to do concerts in Florida anymore. So I mean, we were like one of the number one consumers. So
17th largest country in the world.
I do have something about Florida though, specifically because there are so many people of color who are poor in Florida, particularly in Orlando. I mean, the last time I was there, my dad lived in a suburb called Oviedo, and they were literally just shacks 20, 30 minutes away from Disneyland, or Disney World, I should say. So the Koch brothers who funded Zimmerman's trial should be, I think we need to be more specific because we have more knowledge. So Florida itself is like, there are a lot of black people who work there. And if we just stop going, they're already struggling.
Okay.
So,
all right. Well, so let me ask you specifically about black male stereotypes and the Zimmerman trial. What role did black male stereotypes play in the trial as well as in the verdict? I'm going to start with you, Herman.
You know, first of all, a young black person with a hoodie, that's hip-hop, that's aggression. I think we spoke about this before. It's like there's a cap on you as a black man in this country. If you assert yourself, you're being aggressive. Mm-hmm. So you have to tone back. And you have to be effective in such a like a capped way. You know what I'm saying? We just can't be ourselves, but we got to be 10 times better.
Okay. All right.
They're scared of you before you even do anything.
All right. How did the black male stereotype impact the outcome of the trial?
I mean, clearly, first of all, we don't even have this conversation if the stereotypes aren't even in play from jump.
Okay.
Right. He doesn't get followed if their stereotypes weren't in place from jump. Right. So, and he doesn't get shot if there were no stereotypes amongst black men. You know, he had these preconceived notions that made him get out of the car in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so and it definitely played all the way through, you know, because even a lady the other day, she came on CNN.
B37,
she came out and even said it, like, you know, he could have done other things. He didn't have to be aggressive. He didn't have to come back. He could have went to his house.
She also said that,
like,
she didn't even know.
What are you talking about?
Georgie or the boy Trayvon? Like, she called him Georgie.
But she also didn't say she didn't even know Trayvon. Do you know what I mean? She didn't even know who he is. And I'm wondering why the prosecutor didn't tell more, bring in his teachers, talk about how good of a student he was, or good of a son, or pay more about his character.
And here's where I have a problem with that. So we have a black male, and we have to go through all of this to prove that he was okay and wasn't aggressive.
Come on.
So if we have aggression ometer, because he's a black male, he already starts on an 8 on a scale of 1 to 10. And we got to prove, oh, he was in school. Oh, he didn't look too thugged out in this picture. Oh, let's show some baby pictures of him.
Okay.
Yeah.
Regardless, whoever, if he was a schoolboy,
he didn't deserve to die.
He does not deserve to be gunned down like that.
Exactly.
He was unarmed. He was a kid.
Exactly.
You know, what, 95 pounds, wasn't wearing boots?
Okay.
You know, against this grown man who was armed.
Okay.
And, you know, so we shouldn't have to prove, this person had a scholarship. This person was. But I see that time and time and again, that we have to prove that we're educated and we're not doing this just to be a human being.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. Now I want to play a quick soundbite from Charles M. Blow, who is an op-ed columnist for the New York Times, about the impact of the verdict on his son and him having to explain to his son the verdict. So let's go to that soundbite on Charles Blow.
One thing that the Zimmerman case brings up is, how do we talk to our sons? I have three kids, two of them are boys, both are teenagers, one 19, one 16. And because, to me, part of this case, at least, is about the politics of brown bodies, and in particular, the politics of black masculinity, particularly for young men, it becomes hard to help them to understand how it is possible that this kid is dead and nobody is to blame but the kid. We often tell our kids, you're not supposed to run in public because that makes you look suspicious. Well, Trayvon Martin was doing the exact opposite. He was walking too slowly. Is there a right way to hold your body where you do not draw suspicion? Or does does black masculinity just become suspicious to some people all the time? For the innocent people, the people who are doing nothing wrong, who have nothing but innocent cargo. That's a very hard conversation to have. And that is our problem. That is our conundrum as parents of boys, young boys who are black or brown, who look somewhat like Trayvon.
Herman, I saw you shaking your head. I mean, he basically just, you know, confirmed what you were saying.
Yeah, we don't have time for Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny stories anymore. We got to start giving these kids the real, mm-hmm. I believe.
Come on.
And and you know, and then have them root their actions in a place of faith. Okay. Like I said, spirituality, because it's a wrap.
Listen.
Well, yes, I agree on one hand, but on the other hand, I really believe that we need to educate the Zimmermans of the world.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that his parents failed him in not providing him with some grounding and cultural competency in diversity and bringing him up in that culture. So as much as we need to be focusing on our own community, we also need to encourage others to be culturally competent.
Absolutely.
Be educated.
Excellent.
About,
excellent.
Your own stereotypes. Your own
excellent point, Mo.
Well, to piggyback on what she's saying is I really want us to – we talk a lot about going back to our own communities and looking what other ethnicities have done. And to be honest, our history in this country is very different than any other ethnicity that's come here, because we have been intrinsically involved in the beginning of this country, in the formation of this country, in the building of this country. And even when we did live in all black communities, we sometimes had to sleep. We sometimes had to work in other communities as a result of that. So it's never going to be a quick and easy cut.
Mm-hmm.
We are integrated into this community, and it cannot happen by just focusing in on us alone. I was watching live with Kelly and Michael Strahan, and she became so emotional about her son having a hoodie in. And I was looking at social media after that, and so some people were really upset. Like, you know, she was talking about her son, and I believe her son is part Latino and part white. And she was saying, "My son is 16. My son had Skittles. He eats Skittles. I don't want to live in a world where that could happen to my son." Like, and she knows. I don't think she had to say that won't happen to my son, but it might happen to Mike's son.
Mm-hmm.
But I've read people say, well, she doesn't know anything about it because she's white. And it's like, no, that's the wrong approach. Like, everyone does not have the same position. We're talking about a white supremacy power structure that we're all affected by, not white people.
Okay.
So.
All right, Derek.
Yeah, but to your point, I feel like we have to abandon this American dream the way that we have always been trying to chase it, right? That has got us to a point where we're fighting against each other, even to the death in some points, because we're trying to chase that dream. I think we need to take a moment, take a step back, because now we're at a different place in the history of black people that we've never been, where we have all these people who have education. We have all these different people who have all these skills. We have all these business owners, right? We actually have a lot of the tools that we didn't have in the past to actually make that sever and really focus on our own. And to really, I think it can. I really think it can.
But that's why I said first you need you need a diverse approach, because most people are not going to do that.
Okay.
But when you say make that sever, do you mean just to sort of sequester ourselves as a community? Because we come from just sort of a mixed heritage as African Americans.
Right.
Mixing in with Indians, and there's many multiracial couples and things of that nature. And we live with, you know, our inner cities are African American.
Tino, right.
You know,
so
we have to live with other people.
To answer your question, because I'm glad you asked that question, I'm saying, okay, I'll give Inglewood as an example, right? Where the city council are all people of color, where you know, we have a police department right now who was run by a black woman, right? We can actually sit down and have conversations with these people to say, look, this is the way that, as a community of people, this is how we want our government to run. This is how we want our police department to happen. This is what we want in our schools, right? And actually get the educators that we need to teach in our schools. Get the businesses, the planning department that's in Inglewood. We need to make sure that planning department understands, look, these are the type of business we want. We don't want liquor stores no more. We don't want hair salons no more. We want businesses that actually are making products that
we as people are going to want to buy, but not only us, they want to come to our communities and buy the stuff that we have, right?
And before you piggyback on that, we're going to take a commercial break because we still want to get into our conversation on stereotypes in today's black men. But we had to open up this show talking about Trayvon Martin and the stereotypes of black men as it relates to the law enforcement and the criminal justice system. So we're going to take a quick commercial break, and when we come back, we're going to talk about black masculinity and black male identity and the stereotypes here on the dialogue. So give us a call after we come back from commercial break. We're going to open up the phone lines 323-473-3100. 323-473-3100. We're going to take a quick commercial break as I sip on my green tea. When we come back, we're going to start a conversation on stereotypes in today's black men.
Right.
But it wouldn't mean nothing, nothing without a woman or a girl.
How many?
Oh, wow.
Men think about a little bit of baby girls and a baby boys. Men make them happy.
When I started with a personal computer, new business cards, and my line of credit was on plastic.
Now things have changed, and you have a real job-creating business.
Recently, I turned to my bank for a new loan and found out they couldn't meet my needs. I now realize that after the credit crisis, many financial institutions no longer have bankers with the necessary expertise to understand my business or have the ability to provide flexible credit solutions.
You searched for a better solution from someone with financial knowledge of a big bank and common sense understanding of a small business.
I found Michael Banner and the Los Angeles LDC, who solved my problem and exceeded my expectations. Now, when I have a credit or other financial need, my first call is to the Los Angeles LDC. They've earned my trust by providing the best credit solutions and advice at affordable rates and terms. Where do you go when the banks say no?
Los Angeles LDC, a community development financial institution, on the web at losangelesldc.com or by phone 800-366-1178.
Loans made under a commercial finance lender's license from the California Department of Corporations.
Interested in advertising your business, product, or service here on The Dialogue? Call 323-547-7748. The Dialogue will help you promote your business, increase your traffic, and bring in new clients through innovative and creative marketing packages, including affordable radio ad campaigns for small businesses. Find out more. Call 323-547-7748. That's 323-547-7748. Or go to www.thedialoguela.com. And now, back to The Dialogue.
The Dialogue.
With Starlett Quarles.
Real talk. Real people.
Welcome back to The Dialogue, real talk, real people. You're rocking to some public enemy number one up in here. We are talking about the stereotypes in today's black men here on The Dialogue in concert with our series, The Dynamics of Black Relationships, here for the next couple of months. Brought to you this month by Sex Free, a not-so-modern approach to dating and a relationship, by one of our guests, Monique Matthews. So we want to hear from you. The phone lines are now open, 323-473-3100, 323-473-3100. And before I get into my next question, I want to make sure that I make an announcement. We do have our own rally here happening here in Los Angeles, brought to you by the National Action Network and the Black Community Clergy and Labor Alliance, BCCLA. It's called Justice for Trayvon Rally this Saturday, July 20th, at the Federal Courts Building at 9 a.m. at 312 North Spring Street, 323-389-5130. Or 323-546-8173. Again, Justice for Trayvon Rally, brought to you by the National Action Network with this Al Sharpton's nonprofit and the Black Community Clergy and Labor Alliance. So, and also my good friend Sharice Beasley, who's here from Kitchen Food Ventures in our studio audience, I just brought to our attention that there are 3.2 million signatures on the NAACP website. So they're going to have to do something. So Monique, I'm going to start with you since our topic is on the stereotypes and just to get your perspective as a woman. What do you believe the difference is between a black male stereotype and black male identity?
I think that's a great question. I think that in terms of when we look at stereotypes, right, that's just a general definition of it, is to make a prejudgment about somebody based on his or her ethnicity or sex or background or something of that nature, right? And I think that there are things we have to look at with that identity in terms of black male identity. I think that that would be more than anything aligning yourself, because I'm not a male. So I can't say this is what a black male identity is, but as a woman looking at a black man and him telling me what his identity is, I would imagine that would be to be respected as a human being, and to, by that meaning, to for someone to just acknowledge his rights. And one of the great things I want to say about that is that I don't know how many of our listeners or any in this panel have seen Fruitville, the story of Fruitville Station, the story of Oscar Grant. And one of the things I really liked about it is that Oscar was aggressive. He had his moments where it was like he didn't have to be perfect. And I love that even more, because even with his aggressiveness, he did not deserve to die on that particular day.
Excellent. Derek, what the black male stereotypes and black male identity, I'm going to ask you and both of you guys are black men. So how do you perceive the difference between your identity and a stereotype?
Well, see, identity is individual, you know, like My black male identity may be different than another's.
Okay.
You know, just because of how
I carry
myself.
You think there's a collective agreement about it, though?
No, there. I don't think that's what I mean. In my personal opinion, there is a personal agreement about what the stereotypes are. But as far as the black male identity, you know, I think we're actually still coming. We're, as far as today's perspective of what the black male identity is, we're still coming into our own, you know, because things have changed over time that have affected what our identity is. The woman, in particular the black woman, has come into her own as well, right? There at one point in time she wasn't working. There was, you know, so now that there's an opportunity for, no, I'm saying,
when
I say
our country, I'm talking about
I apologize, I'll take that back. I mean, in the as far as inside, She now has the opportunities to have the same type of jobs as the black man would have had on his own back in the day, right? Inside different, we are both growing at the same time, but she there's more equality amongst men and women, and men in general are still trying to find their identities as things have just coming along. You know what I mean?
Okay, so
in terms of identity, I just want to thank you real quick for always providing this platform for us to come talk. I'm mad as hell. I'm about to go out on the street. I don't think that's effective, but if this can reach some ears of people that want action, real action, it serves its purpose. So thank you.
You're very welcome. Thank you for being here.
Absolutely. Our black identity, and I just want to jump back a little bit, you know what I'm saying, because you were saying that we need to be, you know, an example to other people, outreach, I'm not saying it clear, but our identity is something that goes back so far. I was just looking at Dr. Ivan Van Sertima. That's whose shoulders I'm standing on. Marcus Garvey, Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, you know what I'm saying? These brothers that was really putting it down. It's very expansive. We got to go back and look at that. We have to deconstruct what this what we've been taught.
Okay.
Because the same people that gave that verdict about this case are the same people that taught us everything we learned in school. And if our parents weren't giving us the real, we got to deconstruct from that, because we're teaching our kids that and our families. And I know I have it. Okay. You know what I'm saying? I'm ignorant to a point, but our legacy stands on the beginning of the earth, the salt of the earth. You got to go back and get that. And then you have to incorporate
hidden colors,
bring it up to speed right now. And guess what? Check yourself, check your religion. That might not be working for you. You might be feeling repressed. That might not be organic to who you really are.
You sure you're not a preacher? You might have to call in.
Hey, you know, I did this institutionalized, I don't like that.
So I was gonna
babies up.
Okay,
it,
go ahead, listen.
I think there is some going back. You know, we can look at, you know, goodness, everything from Frederick Douglass to images of the buck, and you know, everything we've been called and transformation in terms of different names. But we can either have an awareness about that or not. I happen to think that some of our
images and the people who are actually teaching our children are a lot of our media figures. So athletes, rappers. And so I feel that they have a responsibility to the community to contain some of these messages and make
what
them
is,
more
what
positive.
Does that responsibility look like?
Well, what that responsibility looks like is some meditation time.
Okay.
Because we are very traumatized as a people, Max. Mm-hmm. And we just need to sit back and reflect. And so we can put all of this into perspective. Because guess what? Flavor Flav is just as influential. You know what I'm saying? He's just as much as my identity as a Frederick Douglass. Mm-hmm. Okay. You know what I'm saying? I wanted to hear some aggressive hip hop.
Okay.
And I realized that there was none for me to listen to some Drake and some Rick Ross and some crap. But hip hop has been, when they killed Pac and when they killed Biggie, they took away, they demasculinized our voice, man. Mm. And they replaced it with this nonsense. I don't think cats have sat back and really figured that out yet. Okay. Mm-hmm. They trying to ride with it. They mad, but they don't know where to put their energy into. Okay.
Mo, I mean, meditation's gonna help you with that.
Well, yeah, I mean, the rapper and the managing editor for Hip Hop Magazine.
I mean, is it the hip hop artist's responsibility to not perpetuate these stereotypes?
Some people, I would like, you know, this panel is clearly really educated and they're really forward thinking, which is why we're on this panel. But some people are just not going to think that deeply. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the fundamental conversations we have right here now are how do stereotypes benefit us? Because there's something to wanting to be, you know, even when we look at Trayvon, his handle was No Limit Nigga. Mm-hmm. He got that from Master P. Mm-hmm. He had gold teeth fronts. That was from Master P. And so people who didn't see that said, oh, he's being a thug. And it's like, no, he's emulating a rapper that he really likes, to what you're saying. But even more than that, when you look at stereotypes, there's a reason that they're existing, and they're not just existing because people outside like them. There's some things that we like about them that we benefit from them.
Okay.
So in terms of looking at black male identity and stereotypes, what stereotypes work?
Okay. All right. So let me ask you, and both the men,
while they hurt,
it's a double-edged sword. Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I'm going to ask you, and you admitted to a little bit of it, alluded to a little bit of your ignorance before, but I just want to ask both men on the panel. So have you ever found yourself embracing or performing any of the negative stereotypes portrayed by black men, Herman?
I wanted to be like Tupac.
Okay.
You did, because his message was powerful. And I felt like, you know, the more I put it out there outwardly, people wouldn't mess with me.
Okay.
And I kind of was playing into something. But here's the double-edged sword of it. Yeah, the black man is strong, powerful, and all that. But then people want to try you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you got the baddest gun, all the gunslingers want to get at you.
Okay.
And so we carry that as well. You might not want to be in confrontational mode.
Okay.
But you got to always be on alert.
Okay. All right. Derek.
On occasion, he already hit the nail on the head. Like, on occasion,
you do have to embrace that stereotype
because it has become socially acceptable.
Okay.
Certain stereotypes have become socially acceptable, so you find yourself sometimes acting those things out. But you know, I'm actually from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, which is only 8% black people are in the city. The majority of them are white folks. So I find myself in a lot of those cases always being the one arguing, like, yo, come on, man, like, that's not how all of us really are. Like, you can't just make that assumption about me just because you ran into some dude and that's how he acts.
Okay,
right?
So I'm gonna ask the ladies and then I'm gonna come back to the
let me say something as a black man. I'm sorry, that everything you guys said is 100% true. The problem is our limited scope of media outlets,
right?
And the negative is what's proliferated. The negative predominates our media image. White boys have crazy things that they do. They have negative things that they do, like they have all those redneck shows, but they're redneck shows. So we don't look at it as that's their whole spectrum of who they are. People from the outside looking at us, that's the whole spectrum that they see. And I'm not saying that we have to take all of that on our shoulders, but it is definitely an image, and that's something that we need to look at, that what we project.
Okay, very good. Yeah. So how have these negative stereotypes, I'm gonna start with the ladies, about black men, or just stereotypes about black men, impacted your intimate or your dating relationships? Calista, I'm gonna start with you.
Okay. Well, I think, you know, much like the shows you've had in the past couple of weeks, there's a lot of as you've mentioned on some of your past shows, there are a lot of assumptions that people have about black men.
Okay.
And what I'll have to say in terms of my experiences is that there's so many different kinds of black men. I mean, you have these images, oh, so-and-so's living with his mama. He must be this. I mean, you know, for example, there are rap songs okay. about these stereotypes. But I think what's necessary is really taking people where they are and as individuals. So you can't assume something based on someone's income or their education. Oh, so-and-so doesn't have his whatever degree. He might be making more money than you with all your degrees to keep you warm, so to speak.
Okay.
As I've been told about myself. I think we need to take people as individuals. Okay. We can't have these sweeping statements about
them. Herman, I mean, how have these the perceptions or stereotypes of black men impacted your interpersonal relationships with women, if at all?
Yeah, because probably I'm every other dude that she's dated before that did her wrong. So I come in with that baggage.
All right.
And not a clean slate.
Okay.
And all the stereotypes that come with it, you know.
So how do you combat that, though? Do you kick her to the curb or do you re-educate her or do you have to feel like you have to?
Well, you know, I continue to better myself.
Okay.
And then I make better decisions.
All right. Excellent.
I bring better people in my life.
Can I just ask you to follow up on that? So you mentioned meditation, which I think is key, and you know, to self-awareness. Can you just give folks a few tangible nuggets in terms of how you've used that to better yourself, create greater self-awareness, et cetera, et cetera? Can you just throw that out there?
Excellent. Absolutely. Oh, damn. That's a good question.
Work it out.
Well, In my moments of solitude, I'm left with myself. I practice Buddhism. I'm not giving it all to Buddhism, but it fits my philosophy.
Okay.
And one thing that they teach is Nichiren Buddhism, cause and effect.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So when you're taking responsibility for your actions, you're taking responsibility for the outcomes. And in that moment of solitude, if you're being real with yourself, you want to change something, you're going to get that answer. But you have to be willing to do the work and take that inner criticism. You know what I mean?
Yeah. What does that look like? So give us a moment of solitude if you can. Are you quieting down and listening to your breath?
A moment of solitude could be turning off your phone, your garage, somewhere where you won't be disturbed.
Okay.
Turn out the lights and reflect. It could be getting in front of a Gohonjin and chanting Nam-myoho Renge Kyo.
Okay.
Hey, you know what? You can hum.
You can pray.
Sit and rock back and forth.
All right, very
whatever
good.
You do to make yourself feel better.
So Mo, let me ask you, in terms of these perceptions of black men.
Oh, yeah.
How have they impacted?
Well, I address that a lot, not just with black men and women, even though I'm black and I deal primarily with black men. Men and women have different representatives when they come to the table. But in my book, I talk about the two of the biggest stereotypes in terms of relationships, the asshole and the crazy chick.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So the a-hole is the brother. And oftentimes when we connect, there's a quote that says, with great love comes great insecurity. Like when you truly are loving someone, you become emotionally vulnerable, and you actually have to work to become confident with that. As a couple, you have to build that together.
Okay.
And sometimes if you become intimate before you're ready, it can result in a couple of things. It can result in the woman becoming very emotional, and she may have that emotion expressed in different ways. She may say, you know what, I'm tired of you and I'm tired of men. So she becomes like the boomerang chick, where it's like she's really hardcore and she can hurt your feelings. Right. And then we have the a-hole who is like the more of a, if a woman says, you said you were going to do this to me and you didn't do this. And he goes, well, I told you from the beginning that we was just kicking it. We wasn't in a no real relationship. And now you're trying to shut
me
down.
I know that man. A couple of them.
Right.
They're laughing real hard.
And he's pulling back. Right. To think about it, to go into his cage, to reflect. He's now an a-hole because it's like, but wait a second. We as women agreed to these rules to begin with, but we thought he could change him.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, this isn't going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not even giving him a chance to see if it could happen because emotionally we're so outside of ourselves. And at the same time, he's now withdrawn. He's like, oh, this is like every other crazy chick. They always seem really cool until now. And I don't know what to do. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And so we are a lot of times attacking each other, and we think men are a-holes, and
A lot of times they're not.
Okay.
They respond and they process information differently. Mm. I found men in my interactions with them to be more emotional in many ways than women. Certainly if they've ever been hurt in a relationship, it takes them much longer to recover from it.
Okay.
So I think that primarily we have to say, okay, if I am getting involved too early, I'm going to want to hold you down. And as a woman, I might not even like you. Mm. But the fact that I'm sexing you and I got this oxytocin, this is the happy gene going off in my head, I don't want you sleeping with anybody else.
All right.
I may or may not be. Okay. But I don't want you doing that. And then we just got issues.
Derek, what do you think about that?
Well, I want she really hit on something. She hit on assumptions, right?
Okay.
Even if you have that conversation up front, there's a couple of assumptions that you walk away with, and when you have that first conversation, you have to follow it up with constant communication, and that's a lot of times what I found is always missing when I'm talking to some of my buddies, and I always ask, well, did you say such and such along the way? Well, nah, man, we didn't really have a conversation until it got to this point. Like,
but
well,
I told her in the beginning.
Yeah, exactly. See, and so. I have a lot of my ex-girlfriends are still my friends, right? Okay. And the reason why that's the case is because I've always practiced this thing called the truth bubble, right? It's like, look, I'm gonna tell, and in the truth bubble, you can't get mad at me because we in the bubble right now. Like, you can't.
It's so hard.
Like, so we exactly. But see, the thing is, if you're regularly practicing this, then things don't become a surprise after a while, right? Because you already know, you know exactly where I am right now. Like, we're on the same page. So I'm actually about to get married in October, right?
Oh, congratulations.
Thank you very much. We've been together for 6 years now. And it's got to the point now where I don't have to call the truth bubble. Like, I'm about to have more, like, we've practiced it so much that now we regularly communicate. So we're on the same page. Okay. Like, I don't ever really have to worry about it.
Let me ask the ladies, have you guys ever misrepresented your dating objectives at the onset of a relationship?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Misrepresented in terms of said one thing, but my behavior is something else. I mean, maybe in high school.
Okay.
I think as you, I don't know, I'll speak for myself. I'm very comfortable with just being honest with where I am and what I want. And that changes from person to person.
All right. So, Herman, I mean, are you dating currently?
Yeah, I'm dating.
Okay. So do you tend to find that sometimes with black women, that they misrepresent themselves and their dating expectations?
And their dating expectations.
Uh-huh.
Well, I know what the sister's talking about here in terms of I'll go along with it for a second, but I'm really trying to get him to see my point of view.
Okay.
I know that.
All right.
No, I haven't seen sisters
bait
really
and
represent.
Switch.
Okay.
I have not seen them misrepresenting.
All right.
They're very serious.
Okay, so when you were dating and then when you, you know, currently dating, so do you guys ever alter your perception or your actions or your game to meet any stereotypical expectations of black men?
So, or to meet any expectations?
Hell no.
No. I tried that one time and it didn't work out too much.
What happened? What did you try?
It didn't work out too much.
What did you try to be, a thug?
Well, I wasn't
a player.
Here's the thing.
I wasn't trying.
See, at that point in time, I wasn't trying to be.
You just crossed.
You
just
said,
you just crossed.
I had two different worlds going on because it was in two different places.
You were pledging at the time.
But see what?
Player from the Himalayas.
No.
You weren't pledging?
We don't talk about those things. But anyway, but what was crazy though was that it had gotten to a point in playing that game that I was beginning to believe some of the things that I was portraying from to two different worlds that I was trying. It wasn't until they moved into the same place that all that house of cards came crashing down.
Okay.
And at that
point,
I made that decision. As you know, from this point on, I will never do that ever.
Okay,
it's a dangerous game because men, we know the woman that we want.
Mm.
We know her qualities. We know that look. We know that feeling. But in the pursuit of getting that, you know, it might take a long time. And, you know, you want company and everything. So you try to just like position yourself to not get stuck, but to spend some quality time, I'm going to hug on you real good. But that's because I need some
What about the women
affection.
You don't want? What about the other women you just dating? You realize you don't want her, but you're still kicking it with
her.
Well,
that's why you make those provisions up front. Or at least you think. But what I noticed is it doesn't matter what you say. It's about your actions.
Exactly.
That's right.
And
unless you got a truth bubble. I'm just trying to say.
That truth bubble is back.
Even some of the truth bubble don't even work. Women go by accident. If it look like it, that. It's walking like a duck. It's by action.
But the thing about it is we're biding
the truth
time.
Bubble can kill you, trust
time.
Me.
But here's the cold part, though. Woman that you really want,
it does.
You got to scale back on her. You got to treat her like the chick that you biding time with, because you can mess it up. Okay. You can go too hard and run her away, man. So,
all right, well, callers, we want to hear from you. 323-473-3100. We're having an excellent conversation today on the stereotypes of today's black men. 323-473-3100. Call in with your comment or question. Calista, you're about to say.
Well, I was just, given that we're having this conversation, I'm curious what everyone thinks, and I'll throw in my chimes as well, about how black relationships in the media affect what people want and what we think we should be going after and what that looks like.
Excellent.
I mean, we've got Jay-Z and Beyonce, we have like Kobe and Vanessa and their relationship, and I think that sometimes people, you know, pick out lives that they want, and when we're looking at relationships, some people don't know how does that work on the ground, the day-to-day, whether you have a technique like the truth bubble. I find that particularly with young people, we're kind of lacking in awareness and, you know, how do I build a solid relationship?
I was going to ask, and I'm going to ask the panel. Yeah. Do you guys know anybody in your life, current life today, that is in a happy marriage or a happy relationship?
I do. I have two friends, one of my best friends and her husband. They met when they were 15. And they've been together, oh my God, 20 something years now, married. But part of they're open to seeking outside help when there's a challenge. They fight and they talk things out and they've learned who they are. It's taken time and they've changed and become new individuals and new couples, but they've been hanging in there and there's been a baseline of respect. But they didn't say, you know, I don't like your attitude, I'm out the door.
Okay.
You know,
that hit the nail on the head, though, because she said that they know who each other, they know each other.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
And in order for somebody else to know you, you got to know yourself first. Right.
Boom.
And so when you have that and you're sharing that with one another, it doesn't matter all the different things you may go through. You'll be able to fight. You'll be able to fight through those things because I know you, though, like. You're acting out. I know you right now.
So I believe we have a caller on. Hi, you're on the dialogue. You have a comment or question for our guest?
Hello?
Hi.
Oh, okay. I didn't know if I was in line or listening behind somebody else. One of the things that I was thinking about when we were talking about things that are in the media, and that is that unless it's on TV1, which is still in the, you know, beginning stage, we don't see a wide range of black men in different types of images. We see the same thing. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking, you know, every single year, yes, I watch it, but every single year there's one black person on The Bachelor and The Bachelorette, and they're quickly sent away. Mm-hmm. And the only black version of The Bachelor and The Bachelorette was Flavor Flav and I Love New York.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you so much for your caller. Monique.
Yes.
What do you think her comments about just the media's portrayal of not only this black men, but black relationships?
Well, I think that as your producer, Steve, pointed out earlier, there is just a dearth of representation and a dearth of images. And so we go into that knowing that. So I know one of the things I did, I grew up and I hadn't seen a successful relationship growing up. So I thought I would cover myself by saying, and my family were really good at this. They were like, you know, I want you to focus on your career. You're smart. Don't let a man sidetrack you. And this was my dad. He was very, very diligent about not being sidetracked by a man. And the flip side of that is that you have to find someone that you can grow with together.
Okay.
And it was easy for me to, if I didn't want to get hurt, to say, oh, I'm focusing on this. Oh, I don't know if I want to get married. So one of the things that I did when I became abstinent is that I had to act clearly, because I didn't know if I was doing it until marriage, because I still didn't see any marriages work out. So I actively looked for people who were happily married. I saw people who were married. And when I got out of college and they got married, it was like, you got out of college, you got married, you got fat, you died. I was like, I don't want that. I mean, I'm sure it's not that specific.
Okay.
But it wasn't an attractive picture. So what I did is looked for couples who were happily married.
Okay, Herman.
The government does not want black families to grow.
Come on.
They don't want black people to do nothing.
Now you're going to take it to them. Yeah.
Now that could be the thing. You know, that's the blanket of everything we're talking about right now. Boom, to the side. Men
jack off because they're trying to feel some like some emotional warmth. Sometimes you might
from your hand.
You might jack off 3-4 times a day. Say, why the hell am I jacking off?
And what, Herman, I love it, and really
it's a void you're trying to fill, right?
Okay,
that void is like personal achievement. And so that feeling that you get when you make that nut, okay, that's the same feeling you get when you achieve something and when you're doing what you love. It's a high. But we don't detach enough to dig in to what's going to really make us happy.
Okay.
All right. So what was the question about?
It definitely wasn't about jacking off.
Well, I mean, it's about
that nut.
Oh, wow.
That nut. Nobody can give it to you. You got to get it yourself and then share it.
And so in regards to black relationships, and how does that play into that?
Well, you know, with any relationship, it's an equally yo thing. With black people, you know, are we supposed to be together? Are we supposed to, you know, we got a lot of stuff
yes,
to deal
we are.
With, man.
Yes,
we
are.
We got a lot of stuff to talk about.
I believe you have a caller. Hi, you have a comment or question for our guest? Hello?
Yes?
Hi, you have a comment or question for our guest?
Say that again?
Do you have a question? Okay.
Did you call the show?
Okay, all right. So let me get back to our conversation, just stereotypes of black men. So I want all you guys to give me an example of a black man who's been very impactful in your life and why.
Just one?
I was going to say three, but we got four guests.
Okay. I got you. Well, of course, my father.
Okay.
You know, not as far as relationships are concerned, you know, because him and my mother might not have had the most loving marriage. But as a father figure and as a man who just sticks to his guns, you know, he was a really good father to his children.
Mm-hmm.
And I might not have been able to watch him and to learn how to love a woman the way that I should, but I learned how not to.
Okay. You know? So now I was going to ask you what would have made him a better,
so
husband.
My father, he's a pastor. And okay. so his church, the church was more his wife than his wife was. And so it was just more attention to some of the things that the things that I ended up doing as the oldest male next to my father for my mother are the things that she would have wanted him to do, you know. And so from that, and also having her always in my ear, don't do this like your father, don't do that like your father, there's certain things that stuck with me. So now that I am actually a father and now that I am about to be a husband, like, I have certain things that I go into that marriage knowing that I want to do better than my dad.
Okay.
Dude, you are too good. I hate dudes like you, man. You're just making me look too bad.
I'm glad you realize that.
I can't even fix my mouth to say those types of things. It's not even inside me, dog.
Why is that, though?
Because it's just the way it is. I don't know why he is the way he is.
Not about you, but anyway, Mo. Quickly, and we're gonna go to a quick commercial break. But before we do, who was one of the most impactful black men in your life, and why?
He still is my daddy.
Okay.
And in many ways, one is that he didn't have a father in his life. He's actually biracial, and when he was young, he didn't want to see his cracker father. And I'm sure he has had to process that and deal with that. But when my mother became pregnant with me, he went out and he bought books like to learn how to be a dad because he didn't have one. And so even with that, he took me every Thursday. We had our father-daughter date from, say, when I was 5 to when I left for college. When I was like 16, I left early to go to school. So he had been impactful. And at the same time, though, he would tell me not to be like my mother. Don't be like some woman who depended on some man. So he was impactful in almost in every single way in terms of my relationships, in terms of
my brother. My daddy's 74 and he's been in my life and I love him to death. But my brother is more like a father age. And yo, man, he was the first one to take us camping. He's a school teacher. Just like that assertiveness, taught me strategy and thinking through your your stratagem in making your move.
Your stratagem?
Stratagem.
That is the correct word.
Oh, yeah. Hey, I'm open to learning, so thank you very much.
I have to say my father. That's my man.
Okay.
My dad is the best and has always been he's treated me like a lady. He's treated my mother and my sisters the same, the way I saw him teaching my brothers growing up, the things he tells my sisters and brothers who have children, things to do, like, you know, from the grandfather's perspective, telling them about their parenting. He set such a high standard. Okay. And what I really love the most is having him is that sort of domineering father figure growing up. He put a lot of fire in my belly in terms of don't take anything, go back, and you tell that teacher to look at your paper, and they didn't consider this or whatnot. He really gave me that fighting back spirit, as well as financially. Okay. He was like, work, save your money, stack your chips, this and that. And he also taught me to take nothing less than what I deserve.
Okay.
You know, so, and one last thing I want to mention is, I really value the adult relationship that I've built with my dad, which is different than the childhood relationship. Yeah. And I'm in love with him. I love my dad.
Good. Yeah. And we're going to take a quick commercial break because this is a 90-minute special. So we still want to hear from you, 323-473-3100. And before I go, give me the top three. When you hear a black man, give me the top three words quickly that come to your mind.
Awesome, awesome, awesome.
Excellent.
Someone I love.
Okay.
The winner.
Got one more.
Huh? The winner and the foundation, the builder.
Winner, foundation, builder.
Builder.
Swagger, strength, intellect.
Love it. We're going to take a quick commercial break, and when we come back, we're going to continue our conversation on stereotypes in today's black men.
All right.
How long do we have for a commercial break?
Not long.
Yeah, is that okay?
Okay, just to the right.
Are you tired of getting sick and tired? Are you tired of doctors not knowing what's wrong with you? D-Herbs may have the answer. D-Herbs, number one in herbal remedies. D-Herbs' main goal is to enlighten and properly educate people to the importance of human health and nutrition. D-Herbs, home of the full body cleanse. Everyone needs to cleanse. If you eat meat and dairy products, you need to cleanse. If you're eating processed foods, you need to cleanse. 90% of today's diseases that we suffer from are diet-related. Cleansing opens a door to healing and rejuvenation. Whether you need help with a chronic disease, weight loss, or to jumpstart and eliminate fatigue, D-Herbs Full Body Cleanse can help. There's a better way to live and healthier way to live. Experience healing. Visit us at dherbs.com. That's dherbs.com. Or call us at 866-434-3727. That's 866-434-3727.
Your past doesn't have to limit your potential, even for black male youth in the LA County probation system. This is actor Lorenz Tate. If our youth desire a better education and career, now or in the future, then they deserve the support of the community, businesses, organizations, and individuals like you. Bloom is a new initiative in LA helping to provide opportunities and options that are limitless. Invest in LA's black male youth today. Go to www.calfund.org/bloom or like us at facebook.com/bloom.cc.
What do I think about it?
No, what big word is deciding to
write black men? Oh, okay, all right.
It's my own kitchen group.
Yo, Chuck, what's the move, man? I was on my way up here to the studio, you know what I'm saying? And this brother stopped me and asked me, yo, what's up with that brother Chucky D? He's way nice. I said, yo, the brother don't sway nice. He knows he's nice, you know what I'm saying? So Chuck, I got a feeling you turned into a public enemy, man. Now remember that line you was kicking to me on the way out to L.A. Lounge in Queens while we was in the car on the way to the shop? Well, yo, right now, kick the bass to them brothers and let them know what goes on.
Welcome back. Welcome back to the dialogue. Real talk.
That was Asani. Asani was the caller.
Oh, okay. Real talk, real people. We're on live, as you see. You heard us all talking about having to go to the bathroom and Herman talking about jacking off. We thought we were off the air, but hey, it's live.
It's part of the truth bubble.
Exactly. Yeah, right. So we are talking about stereotypes in today's black men. And before we went to the commercial break, I asked you guys personally three words to describe black men. But I'm going to ask you, what would society say, especially in light of the Zimmerman verdict and the whole Trayvon Martin tragedy? What would you say society? Give me the three words how society would describe black men.
Not important, overrated.
Mm. Aggressive, angry, unmotivated.
Okay.
Intimidating, awesome, and wondrous.
You said intimidating.
Awesome.
Okay.
And wondrous.
Wondrous.
Society, right?
Society.
Athlete, thug, rapper.
Mm. Mm. Okay. Now, what can we do as a community to start changing some of these perceptions of these, especially these negative perceptions of society? Mom, start with you.
I think it's the same approach that we have to the Zimmerman trial, to stand your ground rules. We cannot think that, one, we're going to fall into one particular box. I think that we can continue to take this as many ways as possible. So mm-hmm. on a individual basis, when we're dealing and interacting with one another, we say, is it really you? Is this your representative? I like the idea of the truth bubble. In terms of society, I really liked Fruitful Station. Because Oscar Grant was not perfect. He was aggressive. He was not probably as educated as he needed to be, but it also showed how the system had a guaranteed impact in him not progressing, of him being a part of that system. So we keep challenging it.
The Nicene Conference, N-I-C-E-N-E, conference, okay? You're going to look that up. You're going to learn something.
No, tell them a little bit about it, because it's tell you a little historical. Bit. You got to give a little bit more than
that. You know about it?
Yes, of course.
Which one? You talking about the first one or the second one?
No, you brought it up. You tell them about it.
Because quickly, because we had a caller.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know what? I think this is the conference. It's based off of what my mom said. I got to go look it up, too. But No. But I know about this. I know about it. This is where they put down the guidelines in which black folks were going to be received and treated. Their whole modus operandi. You can check some of that here and take a look at how things are looking right now in society, and you'll see it's expanded beyond black folks.
Okay.
This is a national, like, everybody.
Okay. All right.
Human slaves.
Calista.
Yes, I'm sorry, what was the question?
What can we do as society?
Oh, yes.
What we can do as people.
Back to the question.
To start changing our negative perceptions of black men. Start having sex for you, are you trying to say?
Well, I feel that we should completely utilize our capacity as people. So not only in terms of, like the gentleman mentioned earlier, there's different kinds of media outlets. Why are we only focusing on maybe sports and music and whatnot? But I think it goes back to the family unit.
Okay.
Speaking to your children, going back to family dinners. I believe Rabbi Shumley is working with some organizations to do Friday dinners, it's kind of modeled after Shabbat, if you will. But the point is, you know, hey, whether you do a Friday dinner or Sunday dinner, sit around the table, talk to your children, find out how they're feeling. How are they feeling about themselves? It's not just about grades, if that's where you're concerned. But I think going back to that unit, however the family is designed, it's not always a nuclear family anymore. Sometimes it's, mother and son, father and daughter, whatever it is, we have to start talking and taking responsibility.
Okay, now what can we do?
I'll say it again. We need to go further on where she's going. We need to turn inward.
Okay.
Right? Mm. When you think about Jewish people, we talk about Jewish people because, they make the most money, they own everything, da-da-da, right? That's not portrayals that they've put out there. Mm-hmm. We're just looking at the things that they've been able to do because they focus inward, and they do their own thing. We need to do our same thing.
Right. Okay.
Stop worrying about trying to change the perceptions of other people about how they feel about us. No, we need to reconvene to each other. They'll see when we get it done.
Okay. All right. Do we still have a caller on hold? Okay. Hi, caller. You're on with the dialogue. You have a comment or question for our guest? Hello? Okay.
I mean, just to piggyback on that question, there's frequencies in the music that we listen to, in the images that we see. And I studied media, film, and TV like you did. And it is definitely subliminal messages going on. We got to detach from that.
Okay.
In that organic.
So I'm gonna ask you about some specific in the final 15 minutes of our show, some specific stereotypes about Black men, and then get your feedback on solutions. So what is the stereotype of Black men as leaders currently? How are they perceived as leaders, and what can we do to change or improve that perception?
The perception of
Black men as leaders.
As leaders. Well. But there's different types. I'll start, for instance, with the church, right? Right now, there's a stereotype that is trying to be put together about these Black leaders in the churches as thieves or as
pimps
or even molesters, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. And so those congregations or those churches really need to get together with their pastors and say, look, these are the things that we need to definitely want to focus in on, and these are the things that we believe, and these are the things that we want you to understand and exemplify.
Excellent.
Right? And if you're not going to be those, then we need to choose somebody else.
Excellent.
Mo,
what are the perceptions of Black men as leaders, and how can we improve or change those?
Well, I mean, the leader of the free world right now is a Black man, so we have to always acknowledge that. And even when they say the government doesn't want us there, there's always ironies because the first family is Black man, Black woman.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that in terms of how we look at leaders, I mean, we have Barack Obama on one. And then there are, you know, the shuffling politician mm-hmm. who we don't. And I just think that one of the good things about it is that we're starting to delineate and say, well, they're not all in one bag.
Okay.
And I think we just continue to accentuate the ones we want, and the ones we don't, we call them out. We stop supporting them.
So we need to start holding them accountable.
There exactly.
Yeah. All right, Herman, how do we redefine Black male leadership?
How do we redefine it? Well, I think, first of all, it's defined in society as either rollover
mm-hmm.
or corruptible.
Mm.
And the prime images of that, to me, are Jesse Jackson and Al Sharpton.
Okay.
I don't know how they are able to jump in front of everything when it first comes out and mm-hmm. have that voice. People say, damn, this must be the voice of Black people. I don't know how they got that. But anyway, what we need to do is go within ourselves and meditate and come out with a sense of purpose and take action.
Okay, mm-hmm. Herman, question. Did you meditate before today's show?
Yes.
Okay, what did you meditate on, and how has that been impactful now in a very practical way someone can use your
I meditated on the whole. I meditated on being in rhythm with the universe
mm-hmm.
and letting my voice being a manifestation of that and letting come out what come out. Just play my part. That's what I do every day.
Okay. All right, Calista.
Derek brought up a good point. Our church leaders, which are often, you know, where we see a lot of our Black male leaders. However, we don't have enough.
Right.
We need them represented in art.
Okay.
In architecture, in the sciences. Again, you know, we do see the church leaders, and we see the rappers. People, you know, I think more people honestly listen and follow Jay-Z than they do Barack Obama, if we're really talking about the young black crowd here.
Okay.
And I feel
maybe that's why they're boys.
And I feel I want to challenge one of your points that you mentioned, Derek. You said, look at these preachers, and if they're not doing what they're supposed to do, if they're doing something wrong, get rid of them. I don't think we need to have that attitude, because that's, you know, our men coming from jail, you know, reentering. We can't have that attitude. They need to be encouraged to be leaders first of themselves on the outside. But when people have paid their debt to society or made a mistake, we have to have a sense of forgiveness and a way to move forward. And, mm-hmm. and my cousin is a pastor of pastors. And one of the things she's explained to me is they're just people.
Mm-hmm.
And so we need to know how to recover mm-hmm. when we've, you know, transgressed in whatever way. So and I think that goes for us as a people. How do we recover? How do we move forward? How do we support each other in forgiveness, you know, where appropriate and whatnot?
Okay.
You know, to create
a solution. Let's move on to a different. Real quick to that, because it was you mentioned that you know, we don't have enough of these leaders, Black leaders, in these other fields as well, right?
Correct. Yes.
And so to that, I want to add, we need to create a a specific pipeline. For those people to come back.
Absolutely.
And, you know, like I said, let's we have black architectures out there now.
Darn
we
didn't right.
Have
that part before. Of the problem is, darn right. But part of the problem is the baby boomer hasn't created a succession plan or an exit strategy for themselves.
Guess what our generation has to do? We need to take that torch.
Bootstraps.
And say, look,
bootstraps.
We got to get to work. This is what we got to do. Okay. We got to create this pipeline.
You want to say something?
Oh, well, what the sister was saying, just on top of that, you know, when we root our actions and our mind state in service and in assistance and help, it works miracles because this universe is cause and effect. That's the law of this universe.
Okay.
If you're having a crappy day, go out and help somebody else. I guarantee you will be feeling a lot way better.
Okay. Excellent point. Simone, I want to ask you before you comment, what do you want to say?
I just wanted to ask a question in terms of how, when we're looking at this in terms of how holding people accountable, to the black men on the panel, how should we look at as an indicator of what a man is? Like, not for me as a woman saying what is a man, but, you know, how do you define that? And I will couch that because we've brought up Jay-Z several times because he's extremely influential. And on his new album, Magna Carta, Holy Grail, he calls one of the stalwarts of the civil rights movement, Harry Belafonte, he calls him a boy.
Boy, yeah. That's
disrespectful.
He said, Mr. Deo, major fail, respect these youngins, boy, it's my time now. So I understand. And he says, Hublot homie, two-door homie, you don't know all the S I do for my homie. So he got money. His indication of marker is manhood is money for him.
I have to get in here because that is a beautiful segue to where I wanted to go to Starlett's point. One of the things is we have to redefine our movement. The movement back in the 60s was towards integration or desegregation, which means integration. And so what we made as our goal that was passed down was, if you can work inside this white capitalist system and achieve that success, then you've done what you're supposed to do. So in Jay-Z's mind, he's done it. And you can't really, he's not my dude, but you can't really fault him for that. You know what I'm saying? Because that's why he's given the blueprint. It doesn't matter if you had to sell drugs to do it. Doesn't matter if you had to stab somebody. It doesn't matter all of that. The end game, get rich or die, 50 Cent. I mean, you can look at it from here to there. When we talk about, I think it was Derek saying, our people coming back. No, the goal from the beginning was desegregation and to be able to assimilate into the white capitalist structure. So they're doing what we were told. I'm not saying Martin and them were wrong at the time, because, you know, we want to have the right to go wherever we want to go.
But it should change.
Exactly.
That's not it. So I think that's in terms of the country and what's being built is like, hey, it's pretty young. Our experience here is pretty young. We can't really look back on a history and say we're going to model it after this particular experience. So
it transforms.
I think what you're saying is absolutely correct. You know what? We did some things. We might have gone too far there. Let's bring it back.
Needs change.
And redefine it this way.
And needs change.
I want to add to that, right? And I said it earlier. We need to abandon that American dream, right? Because what going into integration is what has given us the opportunity to do is to be able to get the education and to be able to get all the tools that we weren't able to get at that time. But now that we have them, now it's time to bring that all back home, baby. Let's bring all these things back here,
like that.
And let's redefine what the Black American dream really is. It's time
to
do
you know,
it right now.
I think bringing it home is taking it out into the world. We have Black people that live all over the world. Our communities are spread out. And I think that, you know, people have these ideas. Oh, wow, you went from the hood. Now you're living in, you know, Beverly Hills or Cerritos or wherever it may be. But we belong there, too.
Mm-hmm.
We belong out there, you know, everywhere where people deserve to be to exist and to thrive there. And so bringing that home is a way of, I think, striving to thrive and also bringing people with you and, you know, creating other avenues and pipelines for people to exist.
Before we get out there, though, do you think that we should organize, come with a collective vision?
I don't think the vision's going to be collective, but
I think both approaches work.
Sure. Right.
No. I think you choose one or the other.
If it's not collective, we're doomed to where we are, because we're always going to be able to have those individual successes. Well, then that makes us an anomaly, because he brought up the Jewish community. We can look at Asian community. There's a Koreatown.
Didn't come to the country the same way that any of those groups came.
We can keep looking back and say how we got here and use that as a crutch forever.
It's not a crutch.
It's not, because
everyone doesn't want that.
What are you saying that to?
I don't want to do that. I don't want to say I just want to stay here. I mean, in my blood, I'm predominantly African American, but there are many colors running through my blood.
We're talking about that, and that's what we have. That's what we have. A bunch of individual successes and a collective failure.
But here, though.
Let's bring it back to love. Let's bring it back to love real quick, right? Because what I really and ultimately trying to say is, if you we want to create an atmosphere where you have that choice, right?
Exactly.
You don't have to. We need to create a situation where you can stay in the Black community because it is safe. Because it has the best education, it has the best businesses. If you want to go out there, you can. It's up to you. That's what you want to do. Because you can do that. Because we've created an atmosphere where you can go ahead and we need to redevelop our communities so that you have that choice.
A base.
Let me ask a question.
We need to bring back Black Wall Street.
What happened to the idea of Black nationalism?
Okay.
Where did that fall through the cracks? Do we know what that is?
Yes.
Explain it to our audience.
Can we enact that?
Elaborate.
I'll tell you what. It's keeping the dollars within the community and circulating, and so we give wealth to each other. We build wealth with each other.
We recycle
Black dollars. We come up with the products for our people to support. We make sure that they're quality. But you know, here's the thing. What we're fighting is the propaganda that Black folks are untrustworthy. Mm, we don't want to spend our money with that. The white man's ice is colder.
Right.
Mm. And that our products are inferior.
The Korean man's hair is better.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. We gotta fight through that.
Okay, well, let me ask this question. So we're talking about perceptions. We talked about Black men as a leader. Mm-hmm. So what are societies or even Black people's perception of Black men as husbands, and how can we improve or change those?
As Black men as husbands? Well, I wanted to, when we were about to go to commercial, it was the three people right. who have made an influence in your life. And, you know, most of us talked about fathers, right? Mm-hmm. And I think before we can start talking about the husbands, we have to really get better or figure out ways to get fathers back into whole homes. Excellent. Right? Because you talked about the Black family.
Yes.
And we had the experience. I can't really speak to yours because I don't know if you grew up with both parents or not. But by the way that you guys talked about it, it sounds as if you grew up with both parents. Mm-hmm. That's not necessarily the case for most Black families, right?
I will say I was raised by my grandparents, but my parents were around. So it was very non-traditional, but traditional in terms of having that.
Exactly.
Part of my dysfunction.
So I just want to, once we can really redefine the Black family in a way that's going to be successful, then we can also talk about what the Black man's ability in his household.
And I want to say to that, the Black man is going to be pivotal to that.
Yeah.
And also in redefining and edifying the Black family, we need to make room for same-sex couples.
Indeed.
Because one of the things that I personally believe we fail at as the Black community is ostracizing our people because they're not how we think they should be. And so they run around and do this, and you know, you might be married to a woman and then wanting to sleep with a man. We need to be accepting who we are. We don't have time to be saying, hey, you're gay, you don't deserve. So we need to look at new family units and how they're going to work to the benefit and the health of our community. We have a lot of people coming back from incarceration. Mm-hmm. What is their plan, not only for supports in terms of jobs and, you know, staying out of the revolving door of prison and jail, but also building those relationships.
Okay. Wow.
You know?
Right. Wow, that's deep.
Mo, what are your thoughts on husbands?
Husbands, the three words that come to mind that you're talking about from what society sees, fathers, good, bad, cheaters.
Mm, okay. Mm. Herman, what is the perception of Black men as husbands, and how can we change or improve those perceptions?
Rolling Stone, breeder.
Mm-hmm.
We can change those perceptions by, again, tapping out of this mainstream thought. Stop listening to this stupid ass music. Mm-hmm. Excuse me. And get into ourselves.
Do you want to be a husband?
Yeah, I do want to be a husband.
Okay.
I want to be a husband. I want to love my woman fiercely. I want our love to be epic.
Now, were you raised in a two-parent household?
After six, my parents split.
Okay.
And they were never married, but my dad was in my life forever. And, you know, me and my mom and our themed relationship, it left some things with me.
So do you have the same experience as Derek? Like, he learned what not to do?
As a result of his broken home?
I did. Okay. I took, and I'm taking the best of both worlds.
Right.
And I'm in along with my organic universe, and I'm creating something lovely.
Okay.
And it's going to take some time. All right. And what I got to do in the meantime is it's kind of like what she's saying here, man. You know what I'm saying?
Is that why you talk about jacking off so much?
Oh, you know what? Ain't nothing wrong with jacking off. If it's keeping you from destroying somebody else's life.
Very good.
Work that out, brother, man. Work that out.
All right, so we are in the final few seconds of our show. Thank you so much for tuning in. We are going to be talking about negative stereotypes and black women next week. So make sure you tune back in. But before we go, Derek, how can people find you? And what are your final thoughts on black men and stereotypes?
Hey, I think this is a perfect time because everybody's engaged, right?
Right.
It's a perfect time to really start having these real serious conversations about what we really do to move forward. Okay. Marching is good, but I feel like we need to really spend that energy and really formulating seriously, what is this black agenda? What are we really going to do to really redefine these things?
Okay, and how can people find you at the Social Justice Learning
Man, you
Institute?
You can look at sjli-cp.org, or you can reach out to me at dsteele, S-T-E-E-L-E, at sjli-cp.org. I'm always, we out here in the streets, we're getting the work done, building all these gardens. We're trying to save the community through growing the food. You know,
that's wonderful.
I love it.
Mo.
I just want to say thank you. I love the men on the panel today. They were awesome. Great discussion with great men. In terms of reaching me, I'm on Twitter at Monique Matthews. My book is available at Esawam Bookstore in Los Angeles in Leimert Park, so always supporting black businesses. And I'm also available at sexfreebook.com.
And what are your final thoughts on black men and their stereotypes?
I think the final thought on it is, one, with any stereotype, we have to realize what are we benefiting from,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to what we're taking, what's being taken away from us, and come up with new equations.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Herman, how can people find you?
You can add me on Facebook. Okay. All right, I don't have all these social media sites, but I will.
What's
and
your
I'll
last
let you
name,
know when
Herman?
I get it. Jones.
Jones so, the third, three.
The second.
Oh, the second, I'm sorry.
So it's Herman, H-E-R-M-A-N-D dot Jones, the second. Add me on Facebook, and as I bring, manifest it, you'll know about it. All right.
And what are your final thoughts on black men and stereotypes?
My final thoughts is the cards are stacked against us. We need every bit, every ounce of our strength to come to the summit of who we are. We need to love each other. It's more than just a notion. You got to love yourself. Compassion is the strongest emotion. Compassion is stronger than fear.
Talk about it.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Once you get compassion, once you get that compassion, you can love everybody. Touch everybody.
All
so
right.
Let's get off this BS. Let's stop being scared. Let's hey, the curtains are down. All right. Let's start over.
Little black Gandhi, little blondie.
I'm on Twitter, Calista W, C-A-L-Y-S-T-A W on Twitter, and I'm also on Facebook, facebook.com/Calista, C-A-L-Y-S-T-A. And my final thoughts are going to sort of bounce off of what Derek had mentioned in terms of he used an example of the Jewish community, and he said they kind of focus inward and do their own thing. And I think as we can learn from other people as African Americans, and we can shift our focus and fine tune it and be drawn to that light of our whatever our focus is.
And one thing I often said in just in closing about the Jewish community is their religion is their lifestyle. You know, in Christianity, we don't often act Christ-like. Do you know, he's not necessarily
that ain't all of them. That's not all of them.
That's
a whole different conversation.
Yeah, no. You went with the Jewish stereotype. You changed up the topic.
Hey, it's all good. That's
a whole different conversation.
But thank you. It is. We're going
to
have religion versus spirituality
again.
In the future, but thank you all so very
thank
much.
You, Star.
Eric, Monique, Herman,
so
relevant,
awesome
and Calista.
Right
thank you, Steve. And join us next week as we talk about black women, the stereotypes, and today's black women. Starlett Quarles signing off as my mama's child and my daddy's baby girl. Not son, even though I sound like it, but until next
thank
week.
You thank you, guys.
Yay. Yay.